about why is programming in CUDA so such a pain, but in reality, what I would like to show you is like some sort of introduction to like what waits for you if you want to start trying to program the CUDA. And maybe I start with agenda. Sorry for this small technical problem here. First I would like to tell you a bit like what really waits for you if you want to start CUDA programming. What is really it about? Then I will tell about like let's say the glossary, which I mean all these let's say terms that you need to familiarize with if you want to start programming. Then I will show a simple CUDA code, so how to write some sort of hello world program, and tell a bit about the toolchain, CUDA toolchain, because it's worth to mention this one. Usually it's very confusing for the beginners. And finally, tell a bit something about debugging and profiling of the code. What is really waits for you? So imagine that filter app is your algorithm implemented on the CPU. This has been taken from Apollo 13 movie. And graphics processing unit is like another filter that is like not square but round. I guess some of you know this scene is one of my favorite ones. And this is really, really reflects perfectly what is CUDA programming about, because I guess it was running there. Basically, what I want to tell you is that I imagine CUDA as like this bunch of stuff at the screen right now at the table, that is basically a bit of mess. And I found the CUDA a bit messy at the beginning. First, because of the two APIs that are involved. First is the driver API. This is historically the first one, a very low level API, but right now it's probably used only by the writers of the libraries, but not directly by the CUDA programmers. And the other one is runtime API that is like on top of it, and it's a bit more C++, let's say. As far as I know right now, it supports C++ 17. Honestly, I wish it to be much more C++, really, because for now, well, I will show you the example program, and you will be able to see what's how it really looks like. So if we have, let's say, the graphics card, the physical graphics card, which in CUDA is called a device, in opposite to the rest of the PC, which is called host. So basically the code can be run on the host. So that means that it's like the Intel x86 code, and the code can be run also on the device that is a GPU code. So I shown here on this picture the GPU chip, which is like on purpose. I marked it as some sort of cube. I will show you why in a moment. And VRAM chips, video RAM. So that is what is the physical, let's say, very simplified view of the GPU. But NVIDIA gave us quite a lot of terms to be learned before we want to even start dealing with CUDA documentation itself. Because like the VRAM, the memory in general in CUDA can be global, local, constant, page locked, texture, or unified. And there is one more here not shown, is shared, because this one is put on the GPU chip. It's like some sort of cache / general purpose memory. And also with the GPU chip, there are a lot of terms like grid block, thread, SMIT, so single instruction, multiple threads, shader model, lane, and warp. So let me explain a bit what is it all about, starting with the memory. So the memory, the VRAM, is generally the most frequently we used global, so-called global memory. It's just a name that generally describes the video RAM that is external out from the chip. And the problem with it is a bit slow because single access time is 500 cycles unless we have something, some data in the cache. Is it generally pretty big? Yeah, like whatever we have on our GPU. This is this global memory. And we have also local memory, which is basically a memory that is local to a function. But unfortunately, this is really strange thing that we usually expect that the local memory is, let's say, the fastest one that we can use. That's what's true on ordinary CPUs. However, in case of the GPU, it's not always the case, I would say. Because let's say, imagine we run one function on, let's say, 1,000 threads. So each variable have to have a copy, basically per each thread separately. That means that it really takes like 1,000 times more memory than it would normally take on the CPU. Therefore, since the memory inside the chip is very limited, we have actually on most of the devices only 49 kilobytes to still 64 kilobytes, and some cases 96 kilobytes in case of the newer GPUs. But this one has to be shared with the L1 cache, really. So basically, it's an L1 cache that with some part we can, let's say, mark as a general purpose memory. And so in case we use too many local variables, we got something called register spill. And in that case, it happens that this excessive variables go into the global memory with all the call sequences. So basically, very slow access time. We have also something like called constant memory that is the memory that is basically part of the global memory that is marked as constant, and it's cached among all the processors on the graphics card. So basically it's accessible from everywhere, but it's also a very small amount and it's still the global RAM. It's just cached because it's read only. We have texture and surface RAM. That's very interesting kind of memory that CUDA allows you to allocate because you can then use texture unit to address it. This texture units provide us the thing like, let's say we have an image. Normally we give coordinates as integer numbers because we want to get the image from the memory. It's like a pixel, yeah, or some part of the image. But this texture memory allows us to access it via floating point numbers. Moreover, we can access it using so-called normalized coordinates. So basically that renders the texturing access independent of the resolution. And the texturing units can interpolate between the colors that have like fractional values of coordinates. Okay, next one is unified memory. Basically, is the same as global, but it's like more modern fashion of using the global memory. Basically, the authors of the newer drivers were able to connect the VRAM as a virtual memory. So basically, it's visible via the CPU. At the same time, so you can normally to access the global memory, you need to allocate it separately and use separate pointer. And with this one, the unified memory allows you to use a single pointer and all the data transfers are done automatically. So it's good for beginning the adventure with CUDA because you don't have to worry about like two pointers and care which one to use when. There is finally page locked host memory. It's similar to unified memory in the sense that it's also like virtually mapped, but its main advantage, I would say, is that you have it's page locked, so basically it cannot be thrown to the swap or accessed some let's say non-registered way, I would say. So this kind of memory is usually used when you have a device that has common memory with the CPU physically, like Jetson platforms. And finally, the shared memory that I was mentioning, which is the like sort of internal CPU cache, the random access fast memory, or as it's shared also with registers. And it's using, it's very, the more, probably one of the most complicated things in CUDA. So yeah, it's one of the pitfalls that, that NVIDIA prepared for us. In a reward, we have like, it's the fastest memory that we can have for the GPU. And now the glossary connected to the GPU processors itself and code execution. So imagine we have like some sort of cuboid of processors, a grid. Basically, we address this kind of these processors via X, Y, and Z integer coordinates. And then each of these processors is also like some sort of cuboid of the threads, because it can execute threads. It's called a block. It's called a block of threads. It can have also three dimensions. However, there is a pitfall here. The total number of threads per single streaming multiprocessor for any GPU of NVIDIA except the eldest ones is 1024. So all the three dimensions together, if you multiply them, the number cannot exceed 1024, otherwise your kernel won't run. And the kernel is essentially the program for a streaming multiprocessors. The threads are grouped into something called warps. These are groups of 32 threads. That number is fixed currently. And in the GPUs prior to the RTX cards generally, to the Turing generations, basically the execution unit program counter is shared between all the threads in the warp. That means certain pitfalls, if you have, let's say, if instruction, and it, for example, executes one part of the code with half of the threads in the warp and the other one with the other part, like in the else section, that creates stalls, because the program counter is the same. So it have to execute once for all the threads in the warp, the one part of the if instruction, and then the else instruction for the remaining threads. And yeah, this causes some hindrances when coding, because you need to remember about that, that any if instruction can be costly if you, let's say, do it wrongly. And together with the warp goes the lane. A lane is basically an index of a thread in a warp, so it's from 0 to 31. Then something completely different, the shader model. Basically, it's a number that reflects the version of the GPU, and it determines like the CUDA capability, so the list of features that a particular GPU supports. That's a source of confusion usually, because it's confused with so-called streaming multiprocessors, because the shortcut is essentially the same. But the shader model is a parameter of the family of the GPUs. Like, for example, the GeForce's series 1000 something, like 1050, 1050 Ti, 1080. They share the shader model 6.0. And that means basically certain GPU features, like better supports for the unified memory and support for some extra atomic instructions. Well, this is just as generally listed in NVIDIA documentation. So for each GPU you want to run your codes, you need to check this one. And there is a CUDA version, which is something different. It's just a version of the toolkit, but it provides some, for example, C++ extensions, or the newest toolkits even allows you to use to directly access the hard disk from the GPU memory by GPU kernels. Yeah, I gave here some examples like Shader Model 8.0 GPUs have optic flow support. That's some sort of feature that is useful in ray tracing. But yeah, it requires the Ampere family of the GPUs, so RTX cards, the series 3000 something. And CUDA Toolkit 11.0 drops the support for cards with the shader models of 5.0, so GeForce's 900 something and anything below that. Do you have any questions? Hello?
No question so far.
Okay. Okay, so after that, all this glossary that, it's, as you can see, quite extensive. I would like to show you the structure of the CUDA code. Generally, the GPU program structure looks as follows. Like, you need to detect the initialize the device, upload the data, the input data to the GPU VRAM memory. Sometimes it's explicit. In case of unified memory, is implicit. Then execute the kernels and download the data from the GPU memory. Yeah, looks easy. Yeah, it might look easy at the beginning, but it has some things to remember. And okay, so let me show you the code. Can it be seen clearly, or shall I increase the font size?
It's visible for me.
Okay, so we have the main function, and what it does is like allocates two blocks of memory, X and Y, with the size of 1 million in this case, because this program, the only thing it does is simply adding two arrays float numbers, and store it in one of them. So we initialize them with like very simple values like 1 and 2, and then configuration of the GPU happens. So we have the grid. So that's how we spread the code into the streaming multiprocessors. I can give you some numbers that, for example, typical GeForce have around 1,200 to 1,900 streaming multiprocessors. The top ones have even 4,096, I think, than the newest Hopper. But this grid, basically we can put any numbers we want here, up to 2^32. So that's over 4 billions. Because if this number exceeds the number of streaming multiprocessors, basically the kernel execution for this, excessive indices is postponed, yeah, until the earlier ones are executed. And we have the number of threads. Here is 256, it's 20 multiplied by 16 multiplied by 1. Oh no, that's wrong. 320, sorry. We have 320 threads per each grid element, so for each block. And we run the kernel, and then NVIDIA make their own version of the C++. Basically, we use this three characters, three operators, beginning and as in beginning and closing parentheses, and this is non-standard extension. Therefore, this code will only compile with an VCC compiler, and that means that it has different extension. It's called is .cu, and the headers have .cuh. That means that that it will contain the device code, and it will be compiled by NVCC or Clang, in case you want to use Clang for compiling, because it supports CUDA nowadays. After being this kernel being executed on 320 threads per each grid element, per each processor, and this processor will be 64 times 256 times 30. So, well, basically, it's, I think, quite above the 1,092 in case of my GPU. So some of them will be like scheduled for later, but generally, the call to CUDA device synchronize causes waiting until all the kernels, all these operations are executed. And then we can put them this memory back. We can access it via CPU again, and we free it. So the kernel function here, we have a, like a, again, custom notation. Global function, it means that it's a kernel. And basically we get like the index of the thread and the index of the current index of the block. And we use this to index the arrays. So as you can see, it's quite difficult to execute something that is really single threaded, because the code repeats basically as many times as there are the threads, and this as many times as there are the grid elements. Okay, so this is very, very simple example of the code. What I need to explain here is also another pain with the CUDA, which is this CUDA safe call thing. Basically, CUDA uses the error handling very similar to standard ANSI C functions. So basically, it returns something by value. So usually you have to define the macros that basically do wrap around of the code, check the CUDA get last error. And if it's not CUDA success, you throw an exception, you exit, you print something like the error string. But there is one small issue with that it doesn't always returns you the error of the last call. Basically, it's evaluated lazily. So sometimes it happens that the code, something will wrong with happens, the function, the call to the CUDA function or the kernel returns you an error. However, it's returned somewhere else later by the first, let's say, CUDA safe call, or actually CUDA get last error in this case. So yeah, it sometimes happens that you really don't know where the code, which call really caused the problem, unless you really trace it with the debugger first and check the return values. Well, that's let's say a price that you have to pay for some sort of asynchronous, partly asynchronous design of CUDA. Okay, let's return to the slide. So, as I said, there is extended C++. Yeah, see you in hell, NVIDIA, for that. We have a C++ language. Then I think it could be done in C++ without any custom extensions. We have also two separate tool chains, NVCC or Clang. Usually we use NVCC. Most of the people at least use, although Clang has some nice advantages over NVCC. This error handling is a pain. Okay, any questions about this one? Is it understandable more or less?
Basically, yes.
Okay. So a little bit about the tool chain, which is really a painful thing sometimes to configure it first, especially. So first about the GPU program compatibility. Okay, usually we expect that your program is compatible, let's say upwards, that it runs on the newer machines. And that's unfortunately not that fully true with CUDA. You have let's say two kind of architectures you select your program to be compiled for. First one is the virtual architecture that determines the minimum requirements of the GPU program. So for example, if you say that your virtual architecture is shader model, let's say 5.0, that means that the program won't simply run on anything below that one. But there is also called real architecture, and this determines what GPU your programs will really support. So you can select virtual architecture 6.0 and then real architectures you can select like 6.0, 7.5, 8, and so on. And that means that for each kind of these architectures, a separate binary code will be created. And that means that, for example, if you have even newer GPU and there is no binary for it, the code won't run. In order to, let's say, override this, you can select some sort of real architecture as a virtual one. So that means that the code will be created for to provide the compatibility upwards, but as a price of that it won't be optimized for the any newer GPUs than the architecture selected. So for example, the virtual architecture can be also like 6.0, and the real architecture you can select 6.0, and basically, yeah, the code will run on newer versions, but it only will use the features of 6.0. So sometimes this code won't be optimal. I will explain it on example in a moment because I know that it's a bit confusing right now when I tell you that. But first I would like to tell you about the compilation trajectories. So one trajectory is to binary files, so the one that I described. So basically for every supported real architecture, the separate binary code will be created and all the work is done, compiling and linking is done by the during compilation phase and VCC or CLang. But there is another mode, which is compilation like just in time mode. Basically, it compiles the code only partially to the so-called PTX files. The PTX files is like some sort of source code assembly. And then during loading of the CUDA program, the PTX files are compiled by the driver. Yeah, so they are compiled by the driver using runtime. And that gives you the advantage that you can run that code on the newer GPU even if you forgot to mention its architecture in the build system file, so as an option for a compiler. It won't be, let's say, optimized. The code won't be optimal for this newer. It won't take any advantage of the newer architectures. And the third thing is something really new called NVRTC, and all the files, basically from the C++ source, you can compile the code like inside your code, I would say. But the problem with that approach is that you need to separate any code made from the device from the code of the host, because NVRTC won't compile the code that is made from the x86 CPU. So basically you will end up with linker errors if there is any in the CU files, if there is anything like done for the, if there is any code that is for the CPU in there. Okay, so maybe let me show you the. Here is the CMake file for the GPUs. Yeah, and there are like a special flags, for example, to use the fast math in case of the debug info release with debug info configuration. But the most important is the section NVCC flags. Yeah, because we select here the GPU architecture option, it's compute 5.0. That's the virtual architecture. And then the GPU code is for 5.0, 6.0, 6.1. Yeah, so this GPUs with that architecture will receive the binary code. We can also, of course, select it here, like compute. That will mean that this code for 5.0 will be computed as PTX file. And then basically we can run this code on the newer GPUs than 6.1. Okay, so. To go back to my presentation, a little bit about debugging. So debugging of the highly multi-threaded programs is, as you know, like quite a pain. That even if there are debuggers like CUDA GDB that is able to, let's say, stop the program for any thread and show you some variables and its state, it's pretty limited use. Very often these debuggers do not show you the contents of the registers, for example, or the correct contents of the registers. That's why they have quite a limited use. So for debugging CUDA programs, you usually need to do it a bit different way. First, CUDA sanitizer, this is a very useful tool. Because it can detect pretty obvious errors like memory overwrites, or if you read from, let's say, wrong part of memory, but also it can detect data races and synchronization problems. So that tool is really essential to play with. And well, the built-in debugging function, it's print simply, but it has very high impact, of course, on the execution of the code. It slows it down because, well, the printing is done immediately. So it creates an extreme amount of memory transfers between the GPU and the CPU. That's why sometimes it can change behavior of the code. Like if there is a data race, well, we won't detect it with just the prints because, the print can change the place where the data is occur or even wipe it out, let's say, at all. So that will end up with the code that crashes without the prints and executes with the print. My favorite technique is honestly using the unified memory to dump the images because usually computing on GPU, it's about most of the time kind of images or three-dimensional structures. So the best is to really inspect them visually to see what really happens. There are also tools for profiling inside compute and inside systems. That ones are pretty nice tools that displays you some sort of Gantt chart with explicitly saying what happens when, like when there is a memory transfer, how often is it, and so on. I recommend to familiarize with that one if you want to start with CUDA. They are useful, but they don't provide you any debugging possibilities, except maybe the fact that they will sometimes tell you what is wrong with your kernels. Like if the memory access is not optimal, it's not coalesced, or this kind of things. But usually it will mean rather problems associated with the performance. Okay, guys, so more or less that's it as an introduction. I don't think I can fit more of things here. Well, I hope the talk was at least a bit understandable. And I'm waiting for your questions.